Morning. I'm Jorge Javier Romero. I am professor at the Center for Research and Teaching in Economics. It's a public education institution in Mexico, and I am also member of the Collective for Integral Drug Policy. It's an NGO, a Mexican NGO about drug policy. And I'm going to talk about the cost of war against drugs for security and development in Mexico. The news has gone, and that has now gone around the world. On September 26, in Iguala, a town in the Mexican state of Guerrero, 43 students from the teacher training college at Yosinapa disappeared, and another three were found dead shortly afterwards, one of them skinned alive. Now we know that all 43 were murdered and were killed and were burned, and after that, their remains were thrown into a river. That event has deeply offended Mexican society. In various cities around the country, university students, teachers, citizens of all kinds have demonstrated their anger on the streets. The opinion is that the crime was an act of state terrorism, attributable to the authorities, since the evidence points that the municipal police of Iguala, as participants in the abduction of the students, and to the mayor of the town and his wife, whose links with a criminal organization controlling the production of and trafficking of opium paste in the region have been made public. This atrocious case is only the latest, though especially horrifying, of many that have occurred during the last decade. Since the moment when the Mexican government stepped up its war against drug cartels during the presidency of Felipe Calderón. Different zones of the country have been witness to massacres, whether resulting from confrontation between traffickers and agents of the state, police and the armed forces, or between rival groups of criminals for the control of routes and markets. Some days before the events of the Ayotzinapa, seven soldiers were arranged for extrajudicial execution in June 2022, alleged traffickers at Tlatlaya, a village not far from Iguala in the neighboring state of Mexico. The war on drugs has taken a massive toll on human life. According to the National Institute of Statistics and Geography, the number of violent deaths in the country during the period of 2006-2012 stood 95,000, of which some 60,000 were estimated to be associated with the war against drugs. According to a BBC report, deaths attributable to the war are amounted to 50,000 at the end of November 2012. 2 days before the new president took office, the American press published a list from the Attorney General's office in which a total of 25,000 people were reported missing during the years 2006-2012. Almost at the same moment as he launched the crackdown, President Calderón reached out to the U.S. for support. The result was the Mérida Initiative, agreed in March of 2007, which represents the first formal drug cooperation agreement between the two countries since the binational drug control strategy of 1998. Mérida massively increased U.S. funding to Mexico from $40 million per year in the mid-2000s to $1 billion in Mérida's first 3 years phase, mostly targeted at providing the Mexican security forces with equipment and training to counter drug trafficking organizations. This first stage, which concluded in 2010, was criticized for not addressing issues of capacity building and institutional reform. In response, beyond Mérida, the second stage, included resources to enhance capacity in the areas of rule of law and stretching communities. The results, however, have been downright poor. Guerrero, in which Iguala is situated, is one of the poorest and unequal states in the entire country. The economic infrastructure is sparse, and it is only pole of development in the touristic port of Acapulco. Traditionally, power has been exercised at the local level by caciques who exploit the formal structure of government for their own benefit. Institutional weakness and the lack of proper roads is the ideal scenario for traffickers who have grown rich thanks
to the artificially scarcity values generated by drug prohibition. According to the official data from the Mexican government as well from the US authorities, Guerrero is now the principal region of the opium poppy production. The control of this production is in the hands of relatively small groups at war amongst themselves, products of the fragmentation of a larger cartel. There is, however, evidence that left-wing guerrilla groups like the Ejército Popular, Ejército Revolucionario del Pueblo Insurgente, that arose in response to the marginalization and poverty of the region, are also involved in the production and transport of opium paste as a way to finance their weaponry and other costs. Using the resources obtained from the clandestine market, groups of trafficking have taken advantage of the institutional debility of the municipal governments, their corruption, and their traditional forms of domination of the rural caciques in order to control local police and politicians and to use them to their own purposes. The poverty and marginalization of the peasants, who have no access to credit, have to pay high prices for seeds, fertilizers, and transport for their products, and lack the technology necessary for crops with high market value, represent an opportunity for the traffickers, who use them for the production of opium poppies or cannabis in exchange for payments that, although low, are higher than what they would receive from their traditional crops. If it weren't for prohibition, however, those illegal crops would not longer be profitable. What has happened in Iguala is horrifying and shows the extremes that criminal groups can go in order to maintain their clandestine markets. But what took place in Tlatlaya in June is, in one sense at least, even more appalling, since it showed beyond all measures of doubt that the absence of legal and moral limits is not exclusive to criminals. State security forces have committed atrocities of the same magnitude under the pretext of the war against drugs. In that insignificant village located at the limits of the three states of Michoacán, Guerrero, and Mexico, members of the army executed 22 individuals who, according to eyewitnesses' reports, had already surrendered. The terrible thing is that this is not an isolated event. Various studies have shown that extrajudicial executions have been a recurrent practice of both army and navy involved in a war that respects neither human rights nor the existing legal order. A couple of years ago, Catalina Pérez Correa, Carlos Silva Fornea, and Rodrigo Gutierrez Rivas published a research about the use of lethal force by federal state agents in operations against organized crime. These professors warned of a considerable disproportion of casualties in the clashes. In clashes where federal policy officers were the only participating agency, 1.4 criminal suspects died for every federal police officer killed. The rate is significantly higher if we look at clashes involving only the Army, 13.8, or Navy, 34.5. The authors of the report also warned that there is an unjustifiable gap between the number of combatants injured and killed during the clashes. While the police and military face more injuries than deaths, it's more likely that the suspects will end up dead instead of injured. That's the case fatality rate, which is a strong indication of abuse. Let's look at the numbers. When federal police confronted criminals alone, 2.6 suspects died per every person wounded. When the army was involved, death increased to 9, and when the navy participated, the number rose to 17 per every one wounded. The data shows an alarming pattern. The Mexican military forces kill criminals at alarming rate. They do not take them to court. It's pertinent to note that in Mexico, all executions are extrajudicial because there is no death penalty. Meanwhile, neither the availability of outlawed drugs, nor the demand for them, nor the damage to the health of consumers of illegal substances have disappeared. Nor has there even been a reduction on either side of the US border. The central aim of the war against drugs, with which was stepped up in Mexico with the arrival of in the presidency of Felipe Calderón in 2006, has been to avoid the transit of illicit drugs to the United States. The results have, however, been poor, for according to the information from the DEA, while trafficking of cocaine from Mexico has been reduced, nowadays the greater part of the heroin impounded in the U.S. is of Mexican origin. At the same time, in Mexico, the cartels have not disappeared, but have rather multiplied as a result of fragmentation, while their level of violence have increased. The case of Tlatlaya and Ayotzinapa are only the most visible point of an iceberg with a deep spreading base that is quickly deteriorating the already debilitated institutions of local government in widely extended regions of Mexico. The violence in Lech is driving away the investments that might otherwise bring development to marginalized zones. The cartels rendered apparently invisible by the resources of the clandestine drugs market have now diversified their activities and have become organizations that operate protection rackets in mafia style, kidnap and impose the rules on legal producers and traders. Prohibition and the war on drugs that have involved not only the police but the army and the navy have weakened municipal and state governments and have led to the militarization of the country, with frequent violations of human rights in the name of a security that has become ever more deteriorated. For Mexico, it is a question of survival to stop this war that was failed in its supposed objectives, while leaving in its wake an epidemic of violent death and severe institution destruction. If Mexico is to recover peace and normality, the resources now devoted to combating trafficking of drugs must be renailed into strengthening local forces and the prosecution of predatory crime. Likewise, a new policy on drugs focused on health and with an emphasis on prevention, harm reduction, and treatment must replace the focus of police and military persecution. The war against drugs has already caused tremendous harm. Now is the moment to call a halt.